Now to move to our next speaker, to Dmitry. You have been talking about travel identification becoming an evidence accumulation process that we will, as we already discussed yesterday, we will be collecting information coming from different sources. And now leaving a little bit the biometrics, what would you see as the techniques or technology solution, information sources that will that might become operational very soon? I mean, in particular, those AI solutions and new sources of information. If you could elaborate on that a little bit.
Okay, in fact, as the last slide of my presentation has shown, there are major implications in moving from checkpoint to a continuum. And one of those implications is that authentication is no longer done at a point. You could start tracking a person from the time he or she buys the ticket. And in fact, it is very important to understand that no longer we're talking about authentication only. It's coupled with trust detection and risk assessment evaluation. So both of those things are happening at the same time. So essentially, even in this context, biometrics is getting a new meaning. It's not only technology for automatic authentication of individuals, it's also for automated detection of intents, emotions, health conditions. So this is one of the major implications which I think we will soon be leveraging when we deploy the systems. Now, I wanted really to add to the previous comment on the fusion. Fusion becomes very important. In fact, one of the key objectives of our study was to analyze the performance of iris and face modalities. And we have looked at the study done in Spain, where face is used only, and then face combined with fingerprints. And using face only has a rejection rate of 10-12%. By adding a fingerprint, this is decreased to almost 3.5%. This is a major decrease. Now, imagine that iris is always available. In fact, it is. We are not just using it. Do you know that contemporary 5-megapixel cameras are capable of capturing iris, which is of sufficient quality to be used for authentication, but it is not used yet. Now, do you also know that iris is becoming a preferred modality for ID, national ID programs? Like Brazil, for example, have announced they have chosen, out of 3 modalities, they have chosen iris as the best modality for a breeder document. So iris will be there. So, and thirdly, iris can be captured, as mentioned, at the same time. So you use the same procedure at e-gate, but you capture also iris. Now you have 2 iris. So the capacity for improvement for iris is actually 2-3 orders of magnitude better than for faces. So iris provides a huge potential for improvement of performance. So this is why we're saying it should not be discarded from the discussion yet. So this is to essentially our key conclusions from our study, in particular related to iris and faces.
Okay, I have a second question for you. It's related actually to the fact that we have humans, we have automated solutions at the border in the travel authentication component, and there are certain areas where intuitively one would think the human is better. For instance, like deception detection. I mean, this is not necessarily strictly related to border control, but it has been proven in many studies that actually the machine does much better, and the human is the same as throwing a coin, so basically it's not necessary. And this is something which is not so intuitive, but on the other hand, Frontex did some research on evaluation of document inspection system and compared how humans versus the machines perform, and also in the combination, and it turned out that the best experts by far outperform the machines, and this is something you would think, wow, the machine should be much better in that, you know. So there are a lot of surprises. Of course, this is lab research, so you cannot transfer it one to one, you know, to make certain decisions. But how do you see the research in that area should focus in the future? I mean, human-machine interaction, human-machine optimization. Could you say a few words on that?
Indeed. This is a very good topic. I would love to discuss it. In particular, I remember in the morning, Rob Rosenberg mentioned machines are to be used for donkey tasks. We say yes, of course, for donkey tasks, for sure, but also for helping officers, humans, to do intelligent, more intelligent tasks. And what Jakub is saying, there are at least two tasks where we believe machines can help significantly. One of them is document authentication. The other one is intent authentication, like lie detection. You know, the polygraphs have been used for many years for lie detection. These are the machines, right? So it's extreme example, of course. You cannot put a polygraph in a gate, but who knows? Maybe a slightly softer version of a lie detection could be put there just to check the pulse rate, for example. You know, it's very easy, and then generate questions. Are you tired? You could develop what is called a Turing machine. So essentially a machine which acts like a human, like a border officer. And I believe this is a huge potential for this type of automation to be added to border control.
Okay, are there any questions from the audience? Sure, you can, of course, you can comment on each other.
Yes. I have very not appropriate question, but still, how many of the five pillars that you've mentioned are applicable to in the land border context when you have traffic flow, which is basically in cars, and you have issues related to queues and so forth? So is that something that you are also considering how to roll out this to in the context of land borders? And the question for the predecessor, in terms of the problems related to the taking fingerprints, how many, or can you quantify to what extent problems with the, for example, with the transactions when it comes to Eurodac are linked to what specific problem? Why transactions are not successful of fingerprints? Dirt, you mentioned, spoofs, fingerprints being damaged, and so forth. Do you have any estimation of the shares? If you could give some indications, yes. Thank you.
Yeah, I will gladly follow up on your question. Those five pillars, they exist already. We are using them to a smaller or lesser or higher degree. For land boarding, of course, we already have special lanes for Nexus or for registered travelers. Of course, we're doing manual screening, you know. We would love to be adding some automation to interviewing process. Why not? Questions can be generated automatically. So that's possible. But I would not jump into land border yet, because air mode of transportation is easier. It's a shorter term. So I would really focus first on developing solutions for air mode of transportation and then extend those to land. But still talking about two other pillars, yes, self-service kiosk, of course, why not? They can be, in fact, what we've heard from Estonia, this is a type of self-service. People declare, put information about their arrival well in advance. You know, this is one of those pillars which has been already deployed. Now, authentication, biometric-enabled authentication, it's more challenging to do it in outdoor environment. Just outdoor environment is less controlled, many more factors. But I think eventually if we use multiple biometrics, iris, face, fingerprints, eventually we'll get there.
So I think to address your second question, it's a quite simple answer. No, as a central entity looking after the systems, so it's not just the case for Eurodac, it would apply to any of the three large-scale systems. We have no visibility on really the reason. Well, we do have some visibility on the data in terms of the count, how much data that's there, etc., but very little more. The data that's submitted to our systems is owned by the submitting member states. They submit it, they are managing it. When it's due to be deleted, they are deleting it. So the experience at the border in terms of if we had problems, if we had to enroll several times, if we had to use specific devices, if there was dirt, if we had to clean their fingers, etc., is completely opaque to us. We see none of that. So to get answers to those questions, you would need to go to the operational guys who, in fact, Frontex are dealing with more so, to actually discuss with them. That's not to say there's not projects looking at this, and there are some proposed projects that may be taken forward in the coming years to look at aspects of this. One that we are somewhat involved in is actually looking at the MSI sensors that I did mention in my presentation to see if they can address issues with, for example, dirt, damaged fingers, etc., etc. So that's in the Eurodac context. We're doing that test because we've been told that there's issues. But in terms of quantification of the issues, I have no figures at all and never will.
Okay, thank you. I will now jump to the next topic. We have still two topics to go and very limited time. Don't please ignore that.